Good evening, everyone. Pleasure to welcome Professor Sukhatme to IIT Gandhinagar. Professor Sukhatme, as you know, is Emeritus Professor of IIT Bombay and also Distinguished Honorary Professor of IIT Gandhinagar. So he completed his doctoral studies at MIT, and after completing his doctoral studies, he moved to India and he joined us IIT Bombay as a member of faculty in 1965. So ever since then, he has been affiliated with IIT Bombay. From 1995 to 2000, he served as the director of IIT Bombay. And after retiring in 2000, he served as the chairman of the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board from 2000 to 2005. His areas of specialization include heat transfer and energy. He is actually an author of well-known books on heat transfer and also on solar energy. He is also the recipient of many honors, including Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology in 1983, Lifetime Achievement Award of IIT Bombay. In fact, he is the first recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award from IIT Bombay, and also Padma Shri from Government of India in 2001. He is a fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Indian National Academy of Engineering, Indian National Science Academy, and National Academy of Sciences. So today and tomorrow, Professor Sukhatme will be giving two lectures. And the lecture is going to be on the topic of the role of renewable energy in meeting India's electricity needs in the future. So today is going to be 1 hour and tomorrow is going to be also 1 hour at the same time. So you're also welcome to attend tomorrow's lecture at the same time. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Professor Sukhatme here and to give the lecture.
Thank you. cupcake for the time being. Okay, what I intend to do is to proceed as follows. I'll first introduce the subject. I'll then talk quite a bit on topic number two, that is estimating what is our future. If I say renewable energy sources have to, what role they have to play, first you will ask me the question, how much do we need in the future? And we spent quite a lot of time there. Then I'll give some data from some countries, which gives you a picture of what's happening in other countries. And then I'll come to the issue of what is the potential of renewable energy sources to meet the need that we are seeing. So Hello. Topics 2 and 4 are the key topics. And at the 5, topic number 5, which is on sustainable development and frugality, I will give you some ideas which are applicable not just to India, but to all countries. That's the way I'll proceed. And then make some concluding remarks but to give you a sort of conclusion of what we've done over today. That's the way I'll proceed. The purpose of giving notes in advance is that you can keep something for record or throw it away if you don't think it's useful. But the point is, I'd like you to hear from time to time what I have to say. There is a certain amount of engineering in what I'll say. There's a certain amount of what I call it estimating things in the future. Future is always uncertain. There's a certain amount of social things that I talk about. So it's a combination of various things. And many people refer to this as not engineering, but as social engineering. You're talking about things which affect all of us. And yet try to bring in some science and engineering. That's what we are really doing. All right. Now let's introduce the subject. The subject today, India's needs for electricity, electrical energy, are supplied through three main sources. Fossil fuels, that means coal, oil and natural gas, three main fossil fuels. Then by renewable energy sources, by which we mean solar energy in its direct form or indirect form. Direct form means solar energy used say which falls on photovoltaic cells and generates electricity. Solar energy which falls say on a fluid like water, if you heat it to high temperatures, the water will become steam. That steam can be used to run a power plant and then that generates electricity. That's the direct way. The indirect way is the sun causes winds to go around the earth. Use that wind energy. The indirect way is water flowing down rivers. All that is happening because the sun is shining and creating all our weather cycles and climate cycles. That's an indirect way. And so on. So indirect ways, indirectly or directly, it's all solar energy. We call them all together as renewable energy. And I hope you understand when I say fossil fuels are not renewable. That's the main difference from a renewable source. Non-renewable in the sense fossil fuels which exist on the earth today have been formed over millions of years. We are going to use them all up in a few hundred years. And so for all purposes, they are not renewable. So eventually, whether we like it or not, it has to be the earth, we on earth, have to get our electricity and energy from renewable sources. That is no doubt, on that there is no doubt. When that happens is a matter of discussion. And of course, some energy also today for India comes from nuclear energy. And you know we have nuclear power reactors in a number of locations, generating small amounts, but still that's important for us in India. Today, the present scenario is that the installed capacity of the country is about 344,000 megawatts. Okay, that's the installed capacity in India. Give or take a little. Overall, broadly, the numbers that some interest. And in terms of installed capacity, fossil fuels supply 71% of our energy. Hydroelectric power, which is renewable, 14%. Nuclear, 2%. And other renewable sources, hydroelectric power is also renewable source. Renewable sources, solar, wind, etc., supply 13% of our energy. Among the others, the two main suppliers at the moment are number one,
wind power and the other is photovoltaic power. These are the two main contributors to what we call as other renewable sources today in India and in many countries for that matter. So that's the scene today. All right. Now, if we look at the electricity that is produced from all these sources today, I have put an approximate figure, it, you know, plus minus few percent is not the point, I just want to give a feel for it. It is around 1300 terawatt hours of electricity, electrical energy is produced every year in India today, every year, yes. And that is a huge number, by the way, 1300 terawatt hour is not a small amount of energy, okay. I mean, go back some of you and ask yourself how many terawatt hours you use on this campus. Can anybody give me an idea? Is it 1 terawatt hour per year? What would you say? Half a terawatt hour, 0.1? Go back and calculate it roughly. Get an estimate at least what it is later. Let's leave that. Okay. But it's not 1 terawatt hour, let me tell you, it's much less than that. Okay. So the electricity production in the country today is about 1300 terawatt hours. It's a lot of energy, but we are a big country with a large population. When you divide 1300 terawatt hours by our population, which is around 130 crores, you get 1000 kilowatt hours per person per year. The per capita electricity, electrical energy available per person is only 1000 kilowatt hours per year. Just to give you again a comparison, the rich countries of the world, if you take the USA, which is our favorite shooting bag for all such things, the per capita consumption in the USA is about 12,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. In most countries in Europe, like France, Germany, etc., it's around 7 or 8,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. All right, of that order. So you get an idea that 1,000 kilowatt hours sounds like a big number, but really it's a small amount of electricity, because this is not electricity consumed at home, mind you. Don't count and say my electricity bill shows every month I'm using 70 units, that is 70 kilowatt hours. So I'm using only so much. Why is he saying 1,000 is too little? When I say each person is using that, needing that much electricity, it means if I'm wearing this shirt and these clothes, they've gone through a mill and a textile mill which has used electricity. If I'm using some processed material in the form of a watch or vessels or whatever they are, or cars, electricity has been needed to produce them. So all my needs, apart from the residential needs, which go into my life daily, contribute towards that 1000 number. Then it becomes a small number, you understand? So don't come, go home and look at your electricity bill and say, why was he saying 1000 is nothing? 1000 is a small number if you look at all our needs for, have to, when all our needs have to be met. All right, now, again I repeat the what I said earlier, because that's important. A significant part of the energy is produced by fossil fuels, right? And that necessitates large imports of coal, oil and natural gas. In India today, more than 80% of our oil is imported. More than 80% of our gas, natural gas, is imported. And a substantial amount of our coal, oil and gas are 80%. For coal, maybe it's about 15-20% of our coal is imported, partly because we have a lot of coal in the country, but it's not of that good a quality. And so we need good quality coal for many of our power plants. And so we have to import it from countries like Australia, Indonesia, etc. All right. So we need a lot of fossil fuels and we have to import all of them. That's one. What are the two consequences of this dependence? The one consequence is, when you use fossil fuels a lot, while we like them because they help us to generate electricity, the fact remains that fossil fuels are one of the significant contributors to what we call as global warming. And I think all of you would have heard the phrase global warming by now. Global warming means what it says, the Earth's surface and atmosphere, which is around us, is increasingly having a slightly higher temperature. And already In the last 100 years, it's gone up a little, and by now people are agreed that if we let that increase go beyond, say, 2 degrees centigrade from what it was, say, 70 years ago or so, it will not be good for life on Earth. Many things which can be disastrous may start occurring, like the rise in sea level, various types of cyclones, weather conditions, so many effects can occur. So global warming is something all of us don't want, and yet we go on using fossil fuels. So that is why it is leading to global warming. The sooner we can get out of it, by we I don't mean India, the world as a whole can stop using fossil fuels, the better off we will be, no question on that. And as far as India is concerned, our dependence on fossil fuels gives us energy insecurity. Energy insecurity in the sense, if you look at the price of oil, I don't know how many of you look at that price, but for instance, today it's something like, I think, $70 a barrel. Okay, a barrel of oil, it costs that much. It used to be $130 a barrel a few years ago. It came down, now it's again coming up. Oil is actually very cheap, by the way. It's not 70 or it's not 130. It can probably sell for $15 a barrel if the countries which produce it want to sell it and still make profit. But the prices are controlled by countries which produce it. If you have the supply and you have the demand, and the person who's wanting that oil is willing to pay, well, you charge as much as he can pay, you know, or you make him pay that. Otherwise, he doesn't have the oil or the coal, particularly oil, and then you are in trouble. Okay? So the price of oil is being controlled by the few countries which have it, and India therefore suffers from what we call as energy insecurity. It's not a good position. We are not the only country. Many countries are like that, but we would like to get out of it. One good reason why probably we should hasten the use of renewable energy sources, obviously. So that last sentence carries a lot within it. One can give a whole lecture on what is global warming and what we mean by energy insecurity. But that I want to at least pinpoint why we want to take up this problem and at least say what we can do or tell what we can do with renewable sources. Now, this is the present scenario. What about the future? Okay. We are a developing country, mind you, and we are, in the last 20 years, I think we can say definitely, India's development has been reasonably good. We are growing, the economy, the GDP is growing at 6-7% a year, sometimes even more. There is argument over how to measure GDP and all that. Let's not get into that. The fact is, India's economy is one of the fastest growing in the world today, no question about that. And it has to stay that way if we really want to become a developed country, economically developed country, so that basic needs of people for energy and for food, etc., are thereby met. All right. So we need a lot more electricity, and how much would we need is the question. So about at the present rate, the present estimates are about 50 years from today, we should be definitely a developed country, perhaps even earlier. But I'm just putting a number. It may be 30 years, it may be 40 years, but it's of that order at the rate we are going just now. And therefore, once that happens, our per capita need for electricity, which is rising at the moment, it's 1,000, it has to rise obviously to some value which is in a few thousands. Our per capita needs would have stabilized, and also our population will stabilize. And I'll give you some numbers a little later on that. So the first question we ask is, how much electricity will India then need at that point? Because that's the need for which we have to work when we start talking about the role of renewable sources, right? Not today's need, but the need which is coming year to year as it's rising. What's that need? What value roughly should we be looking for? So that's question one. Then the second question follows from the statement right at the top. At the top I am saying, in the next century, we don't know exactly when, but about 100 or 150 years from today, the world's resources of fossil fuels will be exhausted. We don't know exactly when. Most of you may know, there was an oil crisis in the 70s, right? When the first time people became aware that oil is running out. And at that time there was such a scare that people said in 20 years we won't have enough oil. Well, 20 years have long since passed, we are 40 years from that, we have enough oil still. And the reason is, those who hold the oil will obviously not tell you how much is there, okay. They will tell you there is something, and they keep discovering more and more and more. Some of it is genuine, some of it is something that, you know, if you sell a product, you don't tell in advance so much is there and all those things. It's as simple as that. The world trading is a very complex business with a lot of, shall we say, things underhand going on. But the point is, we really don't know still how much oil we have. All kinds of estimates keep coming, and we still think there's more oil than what people tell us, the oil countries tell us. But nevertheless, a good estimate is, it's there maybe 100 years, maybe at the most 150 years. The same holds true for coal, and the same holds true for natural gas. So the present estimate is, even at present rates, these definitely will not be our main suppliers 100 or 150 years from today. So that's the second future you have to worry about, the second point in the future that you have to worry about, when certainly fossil fuels cease to be suppliers, leave alone being principal suppliers for us. So the second question is, can renewable energy sources alone meet India's needs for electricity then? That's a very important question which we have to ask. And not we, many countries have to ask, which depend on fossil fuels to a very large extent. And a third question is, can the transition, this transition, be caused to occur earlier than is currently expected? I'm saying 100, 150, which is an educated guess. Can it be caused to occur earlier? Why do I say that? Because we know that fossil fuels are good from the point of view of producing energy, but bad from the point of view of sending up all that carbon dioxide, which leads to global warming. So the sooner that dependence goes, the better off India and other countries which use it will be, isn't it? So let that coal or that oil remain where it is and say, stay there, thank you very much, but we have now switched to something else. You understand? So the third question is, can the transition be caused to occur earlier? And because we would like to remove our dependence, and answers to these questions are important from the point of view of sustainable development and India's long-term energy policies. This is the overall situation as we see it today. And mind you, this is not a question which India alone is asking or should be asking. Many countries should be asking this question. Now, so we ask the question now, and this is the major topic at least today. How much do we really need? I mean, when I say we are using just now 1,000, and 1,000 per person per year is very little, and I have given you some numbers, in Europe 7 or 8,000 kilowatt hours per person per year is being used. The USA is using around 12,000. Well, how much do we want? If I say it's 12,000, do we really want 12,000? The answer is of course not. USA wastes energy. Okay, that's as simple as that. Without hesitation, I can say that. Why? Because even within the United States, you go to the state of California, which is one of the advanced states in the US, by the way. California uses 9,000 kilowatt hours per person per year and lives well compared to other states. I mean, the standard of living is no lower. So there is no question that 12,000 is too high a number. European countries, 7,000, 8,000, and they're living well. I mean, the standard of living is good. So is the number 7,000, 8,000, 9,000 a good number, or should it be something different? That's what you have to ask us. Because remember, in India, any number that I fix on has to be multiplied by the population of the country, and that's increasing. It's stabilizing gradually, but it's increasing. It's a large number. So our need, total need, is per capita need multiplied by population. Keep that in mind. So we have to be very careful in saying what is our need. Not just say, Europe uses 7,000, so we need 7,000. That's not good enough. We have to have some scientific, technical basis for coming at a number. So I'm going to now proceed as follows. I'm going to first look at the mean annual per capita needs and make an estimate for you. I'll look at studies which have been done in this subject. Then I'll go to the total need for the future, that is 50 years from today, what we might need. And finally, I'll go to the social side, saying, all right, this is the average need. But an average sometimes conceals a lot, as you know, if I put a statistical distribution. It doesn't show how many are, how. Let us say, as you all know, if I have a certain amount being used in a country, and the top 10% of the country use all that energy, the average looks good, but the bottom 10% get nothing. That's not what we want. Eventually, some things have to be equitable. So what is the distribution in India like today? Would we not aspire for a more equitable distribution within what we aspire to achieve as an average? That's the third question. So we'll proceed with these. All right. So I take up the first topic: mean annual per capita needs of electricity. And I'm going to talk about two ways of making this estimate, or rather not. These are the two ways which have been adopted by various workers. The first way is a way which is, I would say, more systematic and certainly more scientific, is a way which was adopted by, which was first stated by a number of workers, and one of them was Professor Amulya Reddy of the Indian Institute of Science. He did his work not alone, because it was a very large amount of work. It was done in combination with three other professors, one from Sweden, one from the USA, and one from Brazil. And they took the data of a number of countries. You can see Brazil and India were developing countries when this work was done in the 90s. USA and Sweden are developed countries in the sense of their economic needs. All right. So they took data from a number of countries to see how much electricity do you need for a reasonably good standard of living, decent standard of living. All right. That's what they did. So you have to collect data. Now, what kind of data do you collect? For instance, you say to yourself, you focus on various activities, and they're listed, some of them are listed. You look at residential needs, and you say, all right, for a typical residence, if you want to have a decent life, how much do you need for, you know, the electrical appliances in the house, lighting in the house, etc., etc.? How much do you need for commercial purposes? How much do you need for transportation? How much do you need for manufacturing, agriculture, mining, construction? In various broad headings, you subdivide. When I talk of, say, mining or construction, mining for each metal by metal, how much electricity goes into making the metal from that ore, etc., etc. So you need data, thousands of data coming from thousands of sources, add it all together, and then try to say, well, so much is needed in terms of a need for supplying certain amount of electricity. And you set yourself a certain standard. You can't say, look, use any amount. You set yourself certain standards and you say, assume that the electrical devices you use are energy efficient. Otherwise, you can use any amount and still get the same output, right? So you don't use, let us say in today's world, you would not use an incandescent lamp and say, I need so much electricity. You would use the electricity being used by a corresponding, say, an LED lamp. So that you've got, for the same output of light, you're putting in less electricity. You understand? So use energy efficient devices. Talk about simple lifestyles. And use energy conservation. Don't waste energy. Then you can use any amount, as you well know. It's something like, if I may give a comparison, like nutrition. You see, typically, a person like me, who's, say, a senior citizen, and I have a sedentary life to a large extent. I go for evening walks and things like that, but a sedentary life. I don't do much physical labor nowadays. Typically, my nutrition requirement is, say, something like 1,900 calories per day. That's it. Just a rough number. Okay. When I was younger and I used to have more play tennis and things like that, probably my need was 2,300 or 400 calories per day. And if I was, say, not me, but somebody else of my age, young age, and working in a factory as a laborer or something, he might need 2,800 calories per day. So you understand the need for calories depends on the lifestyle you adopt. But you can always eat more. Today also I can eat 2,500, and what the net result will be, you know, I'll have a, you know, a more weight than I can handle, and probably the consequences may not be so good. But that's what's happening to a whole lot of people. So nutrition needs have to be looked at as needs which you develop by saying, all right, you need so many calories. What's the breakup of those calories in terms of carbohydrates, proteins, fats, etc. And ask yourself, so many grams of protein, how many calories, so many this thing, like that, add it all up. You understand how you get to the actual need based on the lifestyle and a breakup of what goes into proteins, carbohydrates, how much energy you need, you arrive at 1,800 or 1,900 or 2,000. But as I said, as a human being, if I like good food, I can always eat more and spend it and say, I need that. So this study, which I am talking about, is something like that. You ask yourself, for a lifestyle which is simple, using efficient devices, all right, using energy conservation, what do I need to lead a simple, decent life? All right, that's the thing. That's the way it has been arrived at, by breaking up the total into a number of parts, adding them all together. And what did they find? Now, I am compressing tons of work literally into one line for you. I'm saying the net result which they arrived at was the average per capita requirement of electricity can, if you live a frugal lifestyle and adopt all these things, can be about 1840 kilowatt hours per year, per person. That's the number that they arrived at, all right, 1,840, and that follows from the, all the data that they collected. Now, things have changed in 20 years. There are more efficient, energy efficient devices, lifestyles have changed, etc., etc. So maybe that number would be a little more or a little less, I can't say. But it's of that order. That gives you a picture of what people can do with if they live simple lifestyles. Now, this is one way. This is one way a number was obtained, and as you can see, it's a small number compared to what the world in general is already spending, even in Europe. Now I look at another approach which has been adopted, which is more empirical. It doesn't go around and say detail this, 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 and add up thousands of numbers and take averages. It says, look, let's see if we can correlate the consumption of electricity per capita with some other number which is being used in the world today. And the number which has been used, which they used, was what is called as the Human Development Index. The Human Development Index is a number which is empirical, based on data, ranges between 0 and 1. It's a formula which is, you know, which they'll substitute these things into it, and you get HDI. And what are the things they look at in the Human Development Index? They look at the educational level in the country, that's one factor. They look at life expectancy in the country, and they look at the per capita income of the country. These are the three numbers looked at to arrive at what is called as the Human Development Index. So it is looking at education, it's looking at health, which talks life expectancy, and it's looking at economics in general when it says the per capita income. So three numbers in a suitable empirical formula have been combined, and that gives you the Human Development Index. And obviously, rich countries, developed countries have high human development indices. Those which are still developing are lower. And the range lies anywhere from 0 to 1. Typically, a very less developed country with very poor values of HDI would be around 0.3. And those which are rich countries, well developed, have HDIs around 0.9 and more. Now, I'm going to show you a graph. This graph was first suggested about 20 years ago or so. It's being updated from time to time as data comes in. All it plots is, it plots on the x-axis the per capita consumption of electricity per year, all right, in that country. This is a country-wise thing. For all the 200 countries of the world, this data is taken. It's available all over. So you plot on the x-axis the per capita electricity consumption. On the y-axis, you plot the Human Development Index. And what one finds, which was first shown in a paper in the 90s at the Lawrence Livermore Lab in Berkeley, was that there was a reasonable correlation like there. Okay, that's the point which he made. That if you start here with almost no electricity being used, you are around 0.3. Goes up very steeply at 1000, you are around 0.6. Then it goes into this graph. Take the upper line as the outer limit. All right. Now what you find is around 0.9, you have a value of about 4000. All right. Then the value goes up to 0.91, 0.92, and typically 0.94 a few countries, etc. So the basic thing which came out, which was pointed out then, was at a use of about 4000 kilowatt hours per person per year, you had an HDI of 0.9. Beyond that, there was an increase with scatter, of course, in the data, but it wasn't all that much. So some people have suggested, saying 0.9 is a good number to aim for the HDI for a country which wants to call itself developed. And with 0.9, you need about 4000 kilowatt hours per person per year. This is empirical, but in a sense, it is not all that unscientific, because HDI includes within it certain parameters concerned with health, education, etc. You understand, and economic development. They're all coming into that HDI formula. By the way, I think Professor Amartya Sen was one of the authors of the development of HDI 20 years ago, or at least adjusting its value from time to time, about 20 years ago. I hope all of you know Professor Amartya Sen. By name. Now, so here we have a second option, which is strictly empirical with some basis, which says 4000 might be a good number for living, getting to a certain standard of living. Now, keeping in mind, so therefore we have this. What value should India aim for in the long run? Okay. Keeping in mind the need for frugality, and certainly if I am in Gandhinagar with Gandhiji around and Sabarmati Ashram, we should be thinking of frugality in the best sense of the word, and I'm not joking. 1840 would be enough. Let's be very clear on that. But nobody is going to accept 1840 in today's India. With so many cars roaming around and big lifestyle going on, 1840 will say, look, you also can go away, stop talking all this. India is not going to be happy with 1840. So, today's world, 1840 may give you a good standard of living, but certainly no country which is developing and looks at other countries is going to accept that. It can be argued also that India should aim for a value of 4000, because then the HDI is at a very good number. 0.9 is a good level to adopt. After that, HDI doesn't increase all that much. 0.9, 0.91 with scatter is almost the same thing. Okay. So these are two arguments for providing. What I'm going to do is the following. I'm going to adopt later, I'm going to later on decide on one of these numbers. Just now leave you with these two. We'll come back to this issue a little later. Now, if I want to know the total need for the country, I have to look also at the population. 130 crores is roughly our population today. We know our population is increasing, but increasing at a decreased rate. That's the important thing. What value will we stabilize at a few years, say 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from today? The indications can be seen from a table. So I'm going to first show data from our census, population census, up to 2011, when the last census was held in India. These are India's population estimates. Numbers, not estimates, actual measurements from 1951 to 2011. This is from actual census data. The latest census gave us a population of 1210 million. But it's the next column that is interesting to us. What it shows is the percentage change in 10 years has slowly increased, gone through a maximum, and is now decreasing. That's typically what happens in most countries as they develop. First, the death rate falls, and then the birth rate also falls, but not at the same rate, and therefore the net population keeps on increasing at a higher rate. Eventually, the death rate also and the birth rate start matching, and the increase in 10 years decreases. And that's what you see in the third column. You see from 51 to 61, increase was 21.6. In the next 10 years, 24.8. And this is where people got alarmed. They looked at this and this says, come on, forget stabilization, the population is increasing at a larger rate. But typically, as happens in population estimates, this is what people had expected to happen. In 1981, 24.8 had marginally fallen, gone through what we call as a shallow maximum, this number. Then 23.9, now it has fallen much more. Now in the last 10 years where data is available, it's fallen even more steeply. The expectation is from 2011 to 2021, this rise from this number will be much less than 17.8%. It will probably be of the order of 14% or 13% in the 10 years to which we are going through just now. And it will go on decreasing. So people have made estimates of this. There are papers on it. And if you look at the next table, you will see these estimates. I picked them up from 2-3 sources. There are different sources. Some are what you call pessimistic in the sense they give higher values. Some are little lower values. So I've really picked some data which is a kind of an average of what has come in the literature. But the point to note is everyone agrees that this rate will go on dropping and eventually somewhere around 50 years, 40 years from today, it will be almost something like one per thousand or one percent, 0.4% and so on. That's agreed. India is going through that, but a large country takes a lot of time. And this is something, this is an issue which only the people can decide over a period of time with education. You cannot force it on any country. Forcing any such change has always had disastrous consequences. There's no question about it. So the number which we are looking at is we might stabilize somewhere around 1,700 million, eventually 50 years from today or 40 years from today. Looks like a large number, but we should be ready for it. That's the reality today. So I'm going to take 1,700 million to proceed. I have to do my job. Take some number, it looks like a reasonable estimate as of today. All right. So I say the population of India is expected to stabilize around 1,700. And now we do a multiplication. We say, all right, if I take this total need as only 1840, which is a frugal estimate, multiplied by 1,700, I get 3128 terawatt hours per year. If I take 4,000, which also is reasonable, I get 6,800 terawatt hours per year. All right, these are the two numbers in front of us. There's a big difference between them, but we must understand that we have to make estimates. So I'm going to proceed saying that keeping in mind what we think is, this is going to be the kind of need we have, even with 4,000 kilowatt hours per person. All right, I'm going to proceed with that number of 4,000, saying that it will give a good standard of living and we will stabilize at this value. All right. That's a large amount. Today we are 1,300 terawatt hours. So I'm saying our electrical energy per year has to increase by a factor of 5 from what it is today, eventually, if we are to have some kind of a developed, economically developed country. It's not impossible. It is possible. We are going to reach it. I'm confident. The question is, we should know what we are aiming at. All right, now, I've now drawn a graph just to give you a picture of things. And this graph is important. It's not really quantitative, excepting at points A and B here. A and C are current points of estimate. I made it about 5 years ago, so I haven't changed the numbers. But the point is, A is the production of electricity in India. I said it's 1,300 today. Some 5-6 years ago, the number was around 1,000. So A is at 1,000. All right. Now, C is the amount of energy derived from fossil fuels. So those are data points, actual data. All right. Give or take the fact that I did it 5 years earlier. It doesn't change the argument that I'm presenting. Now, today we are going up. Every year we are increasing the amount of electricity produced. At 7-8% per year, definitely we are increasing. It's not a smooth curve, obviously. It's all jiggles on it if you get actual data. But the point is, if I take 4,000 per person per year as a need, and say about 50 years from now the population has stabilized, then somewhere around 2070, we may reach a point B, and after that we'll have a line which is not flat, it will still have jiggles in it, but we'll be somewhere around here. So that's the kind of picture that every country goes to become economically developed. We are right here, somewhere here just now, okay? We have some distance to go, but developed countries presented data for, like France, Germany, when it comes to their actual need for the population, they are already in that flat region. That means the need per country, its population has stabilized to some extent, the need per person has stabilized, and so they are already in that flat region already as far as they are concerned. The second curve that I am drawing is about fossil fuels, okay? And fossil fuels obviously just now dominate. So right now, out of the total, a large amount for India comes from fossil fuels. It will go on increasing our need, it cannot, you cannot stop it. And at some point, point D, which I don't know where it will be, it's somewhere here, it could be this way, it could be this way, I don't know. But it's somewhere, they'll go maximum. And then as the price increases, we will grab, and renewable and nuclear take over, then it, the need will diminish and eventually totally go away out of the picture. So these are the two curves, both in a sense qualitative at the moment. We don't quite know the numbers. We are giving good guesses for what we think will happen. All right. And people who talk about energy often say India should stop using coal. It will never happen so soon. It's going to take many, many years. We are going to use a lot more coal and a lot more oil before eventually we shift over to other sources. There's no escaping that. Every country which is developed and wants to rely on renewables has to go through that same history, no question about it. So that gives you a rough indication. And this curve often, which I have drawn here, this curve is often referred to as a Hubbert curve. Hubbert was a scientist in the Indian, in the Bureau of Mines in the USA. And for the first time in the 60s, he pointed out that oil reserves were decreasing, that oil would eventually fade out, and this curve which he drew at that time in his paper was the first time to indicate what will happen with a non-renewable source. He said this is inevitable, get ready for it. That time he thought it would be 20 years, it's 40 years, 50 years since then and it hasn't happened. We are still going through a period where oil and coal are in this region for many countries, but the point is going down and eventually petering out is definitely going to happen for everybody. No choice there. All right. So it's often referred to as a Hubbert curve because he first introduced it with data from oil in the 60s for USA and for the world. So I'll come back to this figure again just to tell you, but keep this in mind that this is the way things will go. Not so such smooth curves, of course. Actual data is always points with jags and zigzags on it, but that's the nature of the way production and consumption will go. Now, I move on. We've got 5 minutes, 10 minutes today. I'll finish this topic, then I'll stop today. Now I come to the third part of what I said. I said we have established a need per capita and population estimate, so we have a total need. Try to sketch it to draw a graph. And now I say, I come back to the social issue, for at least for India. I say, all right, you've got an average of 4,000, let us say. 30, 40 years from today, good average. But what's the, how well is it distributed amongst the population? So we say, all right, let's go back. Today, what's the distribution in the country? Okay, let's ask ourselves that question. Okay, what's the distribution of electricity consumption per capita across the population of the country today? And what we can show, again, I'm not going to go through details, but first let me say this. An increase in the value of the per capita consumption, that is what we have called as MACE, over the years is a necessary condition for a better quality of life in India. That we agree. Today's 1,000 has to go to 4,000, something of that order. Agree. Nobody will question that. However, having a high enough average value is in itself not sufficient. It's necessary but not sufficient. Why? Because one needs to know how this annual per capita consumption of electricity is distributed amongst the people and ask the question, is the distribution at least to some extent equitable, or is there wide differences, in the sense much of it is getting consumed by a small part of the population. All right. The answer you can guess, I guess. The answer is something like this. Our study, which was published a few years ago, shows that in India today, not only is the mean value low, that is 1000, but the distribution is what we call in statistical distribution, the simple Poisson-like distribution. It was derived by using data for the world, other countries and so on. I won't go into those details. The reference is given, one can look it up. It's a Poisson-like distribution and it is skewed and highly inequitable. 2/3 of our population, 65.5% of the population, consume less than the mean value of 868. In that study which we used, our group used, we had the mean as 870 then. It's now grown to around 1000. And 15% of the population have access to less than 100 kilowatt hours per person per year. It's a very low number. It's almost, these are all houses in which there is no electricity at home. The 100 kilowatt hours is for meeting certain basic needs of food, clothing, utensils, you know, so that's what it's being used for the, they have no electricity at home, these people. That's what we have. It's a very inequitable distribution and this is what it looks like, okay. It shows the mean is somewhere around 900 when that study was done, and that Poisson-like distribution shows that the area on the left, that is if I, this is the mean, if I take this area on the left, that area will be about 65% of the total area under this graph. So 65% and 35%, that's the number. So 65% of the population gets values which are less than 1000. And in fact, if I take this area, that is those up to 100, that itself constitutes about 16% of the population. That's what our study shows. And this is roughly correct. If you look at other economic indices also, you arrive at similar conclusions. It's known, but it's not talked about so much. That's the point. Now, so the answer is very simple. If I say I want more energy, not only do I need to raise the average value, but I need to change that distribution. I've got to be more equitable. The country, if it has to move on, everyone must get a share and get a better deal. And the people who are totally deprived obviously must get a little more than what is being given at the moment. All right. So, an option one before us, continue existing policies. That means you'll end up with a scaled up graph. Today it's at 1000, the same graph Poisson distribution may move up. That's no good. You need a distribution which will be more equitable, which means you need to introduce strong, effective policy measures which give you more equality so that the gains achieved with the higher mean value will benefit a larger percentage of our population. This is the social side of what we are speaking. One is the technical side and this is the social side. You cannot ignore it and say, I'll just raise a mean. In this case, the mean and equitable distribution go together. All right? This is the kind of distribution we'll get. The Poisson distribution here shows you what I would get if I just moved in the same way. I'll get a higher mean, but I'll just not get any change. The poor people, those at the lower end, will get very small amounts of electricity. And on the other hand, if I'm able to move over to a Gaussian-like distribution, which is what I've shown here, then we'd have a little more equality. So we need to move over to distributions which give us more equality. All right. Typically, if I show you the next graph, you'll get some numbers. The first curve, which was the Poisson distribution, the characteristics are similar to what exists today. Inequitable. 65.5% will get less than 4000 and 41.1% will consume even less than 1840, which 50 years from today, they will still be less than 1840, which we called as a frugal value. You understand? That would not be acceptable. You've got to move, take measures which will change that. We need to move over to a Gaussian distribution using effective policy measures if we are to really make a success of what we are trying to do through a developed country. So curve 2, which is what we are aiming for, the shape has changed, the shape of the distribution has changed. It is Gaussian-like, more equitable, and we have 55% will consume less than the mean, 16.4% only will consume less than 1840. Some will be less than 1840, that you cannot avoid. Everything should not be equal also, cannot be equal. But the point is, you will certainly move on to something that is far more acceptable for the population in general. So curve 2 is an indication of the shape of distribution India should strive for while in future, while raising the mean. That's what we need to move ahead for. Now, I think today I need to stop here. Oh, okay, I'll just take two more slides, then I'll stop here. Now, I just want to show you some data for a few economically developed countries and then finish. The annual per capita production in the USA is around 12,000 electricity, Germany 6,600, France 6,500, Japan 7,300. These are typical numbers which I have taken for recent years. And the human development index in all these countries you will see 0.8920, 0.926, 0.897, all 0.9 or just a little over. That's what we aim for. Okay. Now, Germany, I picked these three countries with an intention to show you what they are going through. They are not finished with their job either. Germany, for instance, is making a tremendous effort to go to renewable sources totally over a period of time. There was a time 10 years ago when Germany wanted to have nuclear and renewable. They've changed that policy. They are now adopted a policy which requires the country to switch over totally from nuclear energy and fossil fuels to renewable energy in about 4 decades. And you can see the changes that have occurred. Fossil fuels are dropping slowly. Nuclear is dropping. They've shut some nuclear power plants. Renewable 7.6, 17.9, 22.1, 37.8. They want this to go as close to 100 as possible. That's Germany for you today. It's costing a lot of money. Renewables are primarily coming from wind and photovoltaics for them. But that's what Germany is today aiming for. It's decided on this policy. Whether what happens we'll know or we won't be around to know it, but that's what they are aiming for. Now let's look at France. France is a country which long ago took a decision. It said we are going to rely on nuclear for our electricity needs. And they have done it in a sense. They followed that policy. Today, France, which has stabilized its need at around 500 terawatt hours, from 47% 40 years ago, it's down to 9.1, 9.2 and now 3.8 for fossil fuels. Nuclear from 25.3 40 years ago is now up to 80% in France, and renewables is now around 12-15%. So this is the kind of thing France is heading for, a situation in which nuclear supplies the bulk of its electricity, renewables to some extent, mostly hydroelectric power, and fossil fuels a negligible amount. And France has already sort of made a policy and it's already reached what it wants to do. So it's one country that has completed, shall I say, a transition out of fossil fuels already. And finally, Japan. Japan is a country which has problems and many do not understand. Japan also is an economically developed country. Its generation is around 900 terawatt hours. Fossil fuels few years ago was 80%, nuclear 11%, renewables 8%. After Fukushima's accident, 11 dropped to zero. They had to shut down all plants. They are reopening a few slowly after testing, etc. But there is no policy yet. The idea is they should have less of nuclear. And their dependence on fossil fuels is heavy. From 80, in fact, it has gone up to 90%. With all their oil, coal, everything imported almost. So Japan is a country developed, needing these fuels, and yet totally dependent on fossil fuels. It has to make up its mind what it's going to do. At least over, it has its period, but it certainly has not yet made up its mind because Fukushima accident has made them even more worried what to do. What decision they take, we'll know eventually, but that's the position. So I wanted to point out these countries to say, though developed countries have a stabilized economy in terms of their need of electricity, they are also having this internal change which they have to do. France to some extent has completed and said we'll have this, fine. Germany has made up its mind and is going in another direction, renewables. Japan still doesn't quite know what to do, particularly because of its nuclear accident a few years ago. All right. So today we are going to stop here. And I just drew that curve again to say that France is somewhere here, you see, at this point. Non-renewable like fossil fuels are already out of the picture. So France is at this end already. Germany is somewhere here in terms of needs. It's still going over to a thing in which fossil fuels are decreasing and the need has stabilized. And Japan is somewhere here, the need has stabilized, but it's still using a lot of fossil fuels. In fact, point D is very close to this point B for Japan. All right. So though they are developed countries, they also have issues to tackle in the future. India has still bigger problems because, as you know, we are right here. We have to first grow and then worry about how this will go out of the picture. That's where we are in India. So I'll stop here today. Now, tomorrow basically I'm going to come to what can renewable energy sources supply for India. I'm going to take the major sources one by one and say, all right, from photovoltaics, what can we expect? From hydroelectric power, what can we expect? From wind energy, what can we expect? Keeping current trends in mind in India and the world. And then say, okay, what does it all add up to? How much, in a sense, can we expect renewable sources to give us as we go along this journey of getting more electricity and getting it from renewable sources? That will be tomorrow's. So I've laid the foundation by establishing a need. Tomorrow we'll see to what extent renewables can do the job for India. We'll continue tomorrow. Thank you very much.